All right, Trad, I think we could get started if you want to fade out the music and we'll kick this webinar off. Welcome, everyone.
All right.
All right, I want to share my video.
Perfect.
Welcome, everyone, to the webinar. Yeah, we had a little music. We usually can show the slide at the same time, but technology's fun. Hi, everyone. My name is Maureen Carlson. I'm a co-founder and the vice president of growth, which is all things sales, marketing, and customers here at System Surveyor. And I'm very pleased to also have Trad Kendrick, who I will introduce further here in a moment. Just a quick housekeeping, because you got to do that. We didn't put a slide to it. We are going to take a little bit of a different angle on this webinar. I mean, I hope it feels different, just a little bit more podcast oriented, but not on, obviously on a podcast. So, but everyone is muted. We actually had a great response to the webinar. So this must be a hot topic. It is middle of August. So I know people are getting really kids back to school and back in the mode of maybe coming off vacation. But everyone's muted. We are recording this webinar. And so if you want to have it afterwards, we're more than happy to share it. We even believe the PowerPoint is going to be a little bit of a working guide, and we'll refer to that a little later, something that you could use with your team, kind of a workbook, if you will. And then we're going to have some live polling. Actually, I think just one live poll question today and a survey at the end. You know, we're endeavoring to wrap this thing up in 40 minutes, probably leaving the last 5 minutes or so for Q&A. Last time we did this, we went over a little and people really wanted to stay, but we don't have that expectation for sure. You know, not another 5 or 10 minutes, just if you want to stay, we're here. So with that, I would love to kind of pass the baton over to Trad Kendrick. He's our senior account executive and also deeply helps with the business development side of System Surveyor. And I'd love to have him introduce kind of, you know, why he's qualified to be talking about this and a little bit about his philosophy for scaling a business.
Yeah, thanks, Maureen. So super excited to be here with everyone again. Appreciate everybody showing up that was here a few weeks ago. I think we did get great feedback off this. So I wanted to do something similar and approach it from the scaling side of things. Like Maureen said, I focus on sales and business development. Been in the security industry for almost 5 years now, 2 years with System Surveyor. So been on a few different sides of things. And most of what we'll do today is just relay to you the opportunities and best practices we've heard from our longtime customers where they see opportunities to scale. But for me personally, when it comes to scaling, like with most things in business, I think the first step is really setting the tone by clearly implementing and understanding that customer journey, whether it's internally having processes you can easily repeat so the expectations are clear. It really comes down to hopefully making your playbook simple so everybody's on the same page and can make sure that customer experience is one that is pretty seamless and easy to repeat. So thanks, Maureen.
Yeah, so thrilled to have Trad on the team, and he comes with some great experience. He's been out in some site surveys. He's been there when it didn't work great. He's been there when it's gone a little better. And it's been so fun having him on board here. Hope you've had a chance to interface with him. I hit my 6 years full-time at System Surveyor yesterday, but I've been involved with the company for about 7.5, 8. And I did some math the other day to imagine how many people I've talked to. I've actually been in the industry a little longer than that. I was with a manufacturer, kind of helping them with their marketing. And I kind of just fell for the industry. A lot of people talk about how they fall into it. And I met Chris Hugman, our CEO. Actually, I'd known him a very, very long time, even before that. And he started telling me a little bit about what he had created. And I'm talking the earliest days, sitting at a coffee bean and tea leaf. And he said, Maureen, this, you know, running a system integration business is really difficult. And he was running one of the largest, by the way. He had sold his company. And then really, he was kind of like a chief innovation officer, no surprise, right? At an integration company. And he's like, ah, it's just hard. So we don't have to tell you guys that too much. Of course, we're going to set up the challenge just a little bit, but you're here for a reason, because this isn't very easy to scale. And I think I have to have worked with over 1,000 integrators and people in ops and sales and so forth. So I can kind of see things a little in aggregate. And we're also experiencing, how do we scale our own company? But kind of different for a B2B SaaS company. There's some similarities. This Michael Gerber that we quote here, Chris and I read this book called The E-Myth. I'm talking like 8 years ago. It's been around forever. It's called The Entrepreneur's Myth. And it's a fable about scaling a business. And some of you guys are probably coming as individual contributors to this and a deep experience. Some of you might be coming from, I'm a general manager, or I'm an owner, might have slightly different perspectives, but it all relates. And I like this quote: successful entrepreneurs, which I think we all are, understand the importance of systematizing their operations. And Michael Gerber, he's got lots of interesting quotes, but are you running your business or is it running you is what you have to keep asking yourself. And so we'll play around with that a little bit today. Trent, if you want to go to the next slide. Oh, we were trying to think of a visual that, you know, I mean, I've been to umpteen conferences in this space over the past decade. And I mean, gee, I've seen a million sessions on the sales, the operations, challenges, and handoffs. So I'm not going to say we're new on that topic, but I think this game of telephone is a scalability killer. We even think about that here at System Surveyor. When someone contacts in, our goal is that we know, no matter who is answering the phone, what's going on with the customer. We don't always get it perfect. It's more complex, I think, in your world. But when communication, everybody's not, you know, Trad says it really well, when there's not a single source of truth, then this creates scalability problems. And so, Trad, why don't you talk a little bit about what you've kind of observed a little across these different roles? And there's probably some that aren't even here as part of an integration company.
Yeah. So I think a lot of the conversations I've had, especially recently with the system integrators, small, mid-size, even some of the larger ones, it's usually been centered around kind of the left side of the screen here, sales and estimators giving back their engineers more time. Understand that your engineers are definitely a finite resource. So most of the companies we've been meeting with want to understand, how do we make it easier for basically our engineers to be freed up to do their job, keep the business moving? And those have been really interesting. I think a lot of what we'll relay today is taken away directly from those conversations. Then if you look kind of towards the right side of the slide here, towards that ops and technicians team, it really goes back to just them having the correct information. I know I myself have been out on site a number of times where I have to maybe make a phone call or two and call the estimator and ask in a past life, you know, okay, what's supposed to go here? This door looks different. I don't know what photo goes where. And it, frankly, it's just not a good customer experience. It's embarrassing, first of all, but it slows things down and eats into the margin when you're doing anything like back and forth, whether it's phone, email, Slack. We've all kind of done that. So everything I think we'll talk about today is just ways to hopefully cut back on that and implement a few processes and opportunities for processes for people to make a little smoother and cut down on that. Maureen, do you have anything else to add?
No, that's perfect. You know, this is about, maybe we're not trying to be like crazy features and functions today.
Yeah.
And we're going to have one more thing I want to say. We have a very wide experience here. And we learned that a few weeks ago when we did another webinar. We might have people who have been using System Surveyor for 4 years. They're still learning. We all are. And then we got people who are brand new or just looking out at different opportunities to scale. So just know that that's a little tricky to get to everyone on but we're going to be a little level up today. That's the goal. All right. I watched a lot of Olympics. I don't know if you guys watched track and field. I was totally obsessed with it. I hate to share this because it wasn't the prettiest part. I think we did it well, Team USA. But if you think about what happened in the men's 4x100, if you watched it, well, we know Noah Lyle couldn't participate, which is a bummer. But each of these four runners were unbelievable runners, the best in the world. There's no reason they shouldn't have lost this. But sadly, the baton handoff went really poorly. I can't help but do a sales metaphor. That didn't go well. And I think what we're dealing with, back to our little metaphor before, is these handoffs are hard. So we want to take your temperature though and make sure we're not assuming, and we're going to do a poll here. I'm going to walk through the possible symptoms of achieving scale, because scale could be in your own sales. Am I able to get enough pipeline and close enough business? Or it could be more broadly in the business. Are we meeting project margins? So Mindy, is the poll ready to go? Here we go. So some telltale signs, if you could probably vote on two. I mean, if you want to vote on Mar, that's fine. But your top two, what are the friction things you're running into? A very big one for people is wanting to get accurate proposals to prospects, but it's taking 2 and 3 weeks to do it. That's a big sales scalability killer. Project margins are just not up to par. So even though you sold, the project margins aren't looking great. Finger pointing between sales and ops, that's a perennial fun one. Truck rolls galore to implement or serve. And if you just click a couple of these, we're starting to see it come in. An interesting one our CEO talks about, because he was a COO at his last company, is that sometimes the CEO feels blind when a customer is needing some executive input, and they're like, I just want to see what's going on. What's their system? Where do they have stuff? What phase are they at? So that's what I mean by that. And then the next one, he always talked about a warehouse filled of unused devices and technology. And many of these things are very interrelated. And you guys are voting, so I love it. Or other, maybe we're just completely missing the mark, and I think you can plug one in there. So we'll let that vote take place. Looking interesting. And then we're gonna actually, once we end the poll, we will publish it. So let's give it about 5 more seconds here. We wanna move this webinar along. We have a lot to share. Trad, are you feeling surprised? We can see the poll. You guys can't see it yet.
Yeah, I was gonna say, not necessarily surprised. It's good to see that. I think some of our things we learned are pretty consistent here. The accurate proposals being towards the top so far is always a chief concern. And then sales and ops handoff is always something I think we talked about.
Yeah, they can't see it yet. So we're secretly telling. I think let's end the poll. Mindy is behind the scenes helping us out because it can be tricky. And then I think she can share the results so everybody can see it. But yeah, I was kind of like, we get the secret info first. Let's see. I hope everybody can see this. Chat in if you have a problem. Looks like at the top, 67% of you said, kind of not totally shocking, and we didn't mean to lead the witness here at being at the top, but 67%, it's taking weeks to get proposals to prospects. And I've had a couple conversations where I'll tell you what, no director of sales or VP of sales wants to hear that. But we're going to get a little under the covers of why that happens, because that's a scalability problem. And it's people have said, we're losing to the competition. We can't get the proposal. So demand isn't always the problem. That's a worse problem to have, if there's not demand. Every salesperson wants more leads, of course. No surprise to me. Finger pointing comes in number two. And that probably underlies some of this challenge. So we're going to peel back the onion. What was the third one? Do you see here?
Looks like it might be a tie between the warehouse and unused devices, which we've definitely seen. Engineers having to accompany people on sidewalks, that really continues to pop up more and more, wanting to free them up. And then I think the third play or the third item there that is tied is just project margins not being up to par, not what are expected.
Yeah, it looks like not too many people came in the other. Well, yeah, other didn't come in. So we must have kind of hit the mark here. That's good to know. I mean, again, we're talking to hundreds of integrators. And so we hear these day to day. That warehouse one kind of catches my attention. Engineers accompanying sidewalks. Give that some thought. If you have 15 salespeople and you've got one or two engineers, it's going to be real hard to scale if they're out doing sidewalks. Now we're going to talk about some creative approaches. So we'll stop sharing that here. I hope we shared results just one more time. Oh, I think I just need to close that. All right. Yeah. So Trad, let's press on. Hopefully that was a little interesting to see, a benchmark with your community, right? Now we're going to try not to stay in PowerPoint too long. I don't like to make apologies if you really know me, but I think this is kind of becomes a workbook because this is a little bit of a podcast, right? These are three things that we think could really impact scalability. Maybe you don't need to implement them. They're interrelated. The first one, hate to say it, process is not a bad word. Identifying the potential for consistency and standardization is super vital for really any company. We found it here at System Surveyor. We needed to figure that out because in the first days, it was just so exciting. We're almost 8 years into this company. We have some serious process in place. Same thing should happen there. And I think I'm going to pass the baton back to Trad to talk about three questions you guys might want to get in a room and get in a whiteboard and ask yourselves. Really take the time to do this.
Yeah, thanks, Maureen. So like you said, more of a worksheet approach here, but some of the things we want to give you to start off with and consider and, be really honest with yourself. Try not to assume anything. First question there is just, do we have a defined qualification and initial info gathering process? Is it conceptual? Do we have it down on paper? Just start thinking about that and look at it. Next thing would be, where does that bottleneck happen for designs and proposals? And you might get different answers from different people. So we encourage you to ask the whole team. And then lastly, what happens after that sale? Do we have kind of a stagnant area where we keep that information? Is it easy to access? Really start to look into that. And hopefully these questions just prompt everybody to get the ball rolling.
Yeah. You know why these are so natural for us is this is exactly what people are hopefully asking themselves when they're coming to look at our software, which obviously we're going to talk a little bit about today. The most common one that causes the 2 to 3 weeks to get, an average size proposal out is because every salesperson coming in is doing it a different way to the estimating and engineering team. Can you imagine that frustration? And we'll kind of, this is like about this one right here. So does everyone capture customer requirements differently? So if you guys rank that number one, this we think is one of the biggest challenges. So I'm doing it on Visio. Oh, I'm doing it on PowerPoint. I do it on my yellow pad. I do pictures on my cell phone. I hear these literally all. I heard Microsoft Paint recently, and I'm a 70s girl. That's remarkable. And it's really not creating the best taste in the mouth to the customer at the get-go, but it's really causing a, we think it's causing a bottleneck, but you guys really need to drill in and you got to get really honest here. So I'm going to switch it back to Trad and what, if you ultra simplify this down, what do you wish us, what does the estimating and engineering team we hear wishes they had every single time?
So for the right side of the screen here, kind of bear with me, just picture this basically. Could we talk to people like Maureen said who do this in a variety of different ways? But what would your process look like if every sales rep is giving you the same info through the same process each time? What if they started with the right floor plan? If they don't have that, they use Google Maps, then drag and drop those icons for those different icons and devices. What if they got a picture of each one? And then imagine them sharing that out and syncing it with the team. So start to imagine what changes that might cause in your organization.
Yeah, when I first started working in B2B software sales, one of the best salespeople I ever met said, "I know my five-click demo. I do it every single time." And that's Trad is excellent at that, by the way. Like, how do you qualify and get that information? Because this is going to set the tone all the way down the path, even way over here to implementation. So obviously we're a little passionate, but I think there's an opportunity to look at consistency there. Then the other one is about expertise. So we didn't mean that you don't want the engineers involved. They just going out on site surveys, and you're going to feel uncomfortable in that because, gee, you have 2 decades of experience. You're gonna, these guys can do it in their head. I've met all of them, plenty of them, and they go, "Well, I don't need to do that. I've been doing it." And you got a new salesperson, and Trad talks about this a lot. His, people in his peer group. They may not have decades, but what do they have to gather? And then the next part is how could you get input from the experts a little faster? And hint, hint, in bright yellow, emailing PDFs isn't particularly scalable. We have PDFs in our platform, but that's not how we're suggesting it. So, Trad, why don't you talk a little bit about some things you've seen here?
Yeah, so a lot of what we hear from people, and we'll show you this here in a moment, is leverage your SE team, leverage that manufacturer rep, especially if you go do work, just invite them in. They can give you some input while you're off even doing another job. So use their expertise. The next thing is just really be self-sufficient, learn so you're not having to use that game of telephone to answer questions, speed the process up, and it hopefully makes you look a lot better and informed to the customer. And then lastly, I know like Maureen said, this is something that she's really, really big on, and we all are. Please meet up and try and collaborate and work together in the live platform. It's just so much quicker instead of that old email back and forth, which is really outdated.
When I was prepping for this webinar, you guys may know we have a manufacturer partner program. And, we have like probably out in the field, at least that we can quantify, at least 200 SEs that are at some of the biggest manufacturers across the globe who are deep users of System Surveyor. The last way that they want to be working with you to maybe give you help with a new AI camera or, some new cloud-based access control device that they need to give you some guidance on is for you to email the old PDF over. These folks are deeply technical and they have to be leveraged across. So become their favorite to interface with. And many of them have come to us and said, "Wait, our integrator partners are using System Surveyor. How could we collaborate differently and visualize together?" So hope that challenges some new thinking. And many of you are probably already doing this. All right, so we're going to go on to the next slide. We're going to make this stuff come alive, I think, now. And we're going to do a demo overview with a twist, right, Trad?
Yeah. So if you were with us again a few weeks ago, this is similar, but we're really taking what we hear from our best customers, our power users, and relaying the opportunities that they've told us about to hopefully implement some processes that are easily repeatable, some requirements for your team to focus on scaling out your business. And this isn't going to be the same, and I'll share my screen here with you as a training or a sales demo. If you guys need anything like that, please reach out to us and let us know. We can definitely set that up. Maureen, are you able to see that screen, that tablet?
Not quite yet. Sometimes this little
Okay.
transition takes us a moment. And I don't remember if I said this at the beginning, but if you have questions, we'll be taking them at the end. So put them in the Q&A area of the Zoom platform.
Yeah, please. And then Maureen, did that go through that time?
Yep, now we can see it.
Perfect. It's always the second time, every time.
Always.
But we're starting to hear, guys, just on the mobile tablet version of the platform. It's really something we want to emphasize to people to please use System Surveyor 2.0 so you can go out in the field, get the data you need offline, and come back up and sync it up. But we're here to focus on scaling. So really the first opportunity that's very simple for scaling is just get your floor plan in place. I know the customer can't always provide you with a floor plan. I've been there many times. If they can, it's great to pull in a PDF, PNG, or JPEG. If not, please use our Google Maps integration on that satellite image right there to at least have something that you can drag devices on top of.
Yeah, can
From
I make a
there,
point there,
yeah,
Tread?
please.
This is where we get into our little bit of a podcast or, as a director of sales, when I hear, if I were to hear someone say, I can't get floor plans. We hear it. We say, people say 40 to 50% of the time, I'm going to be looking for my salesperson to get a little creative. You could even sketch it out, take a picture of it. You can replace that later, north, south, east, west. It's really, that is not a good scaling. Like, I just can't do it. We're going to give you like five different ways to do it. You're going to have to get creative. So we have a great blog post on that topic. If you have that often, you know what that actually usually says? It's a little bit of fear of change. People have been doing site surveys forever, so they're just sketching it down. You're trying to get in digital, so challenge your team. I don't think I would take it as an excuse. I know this is hard, but I think there's some really different ways of doing it. And the Google Maps integration, it does have the proper scale. We've got some changes coming up to that. Just let it use the scale. If you override it, you're going manual. So if you ever need help with how to do that, that's very powerful within 30 seconds. And Trad, you mostly say do this. There's some expectation setting. This is bef the day before, preferably not on site if you can. So.
So I would, that's kind of the first or really second opportunity here for scaling. And we're again using this tip that actually an integrator a few weeks ago kind of gave us. We talked about last time setting expectation. That's still something we really would encourage you to have your teams do. Something easy can put into a playbook to tell your customer, hey, this is going to look a little different. I'm going to ask for a little bit of your time. But one of the other steps that was related to me earlier was, we actually work with or have a customer who has his team put in 15 minutes the day before to just mock up, kind of like I've done here. So there's a number of devices already on the plan. Mock the devices up so you have a really just rough estimate of what you think might work for the customer. And guys, this really took me about 5 minutes to do. But when you do that, it's really easy to set up. If you're new, if you're hiring somebody new, because we know there's a lot going on with labor, you can have somebody check this. But once that's done, you're really putting a great foot forward with that customer, looking informed, and you can ask them, hey, how's that camera look? And then hit that camera icon on that navy bar once they confirm that location for you. And probably no surprise that this is the next really opportunity we'd really, really tell people to use to build on is please take a photo of where the device and devices are supposed to go. With any of this, as you're looking to build out your process, basically, ask yourself, what information can I not do without on a site survey? And the device location and photos are the two top of mind that we consistently hear from people. When you do take that photo, please annotate it with the device and then any kind of drawing or text so that your team is going to know exactly where it goes. So it's a really easily implementable step. And then, Maureen, do you have anything to add before we look at some of the element info here?
Yeah, can you zoom in though on that icon where you added the photo? We're going to make some points a little bit later that are going to be really relevant. So P equals proposed camera. There are some other options. You could just get what's in place. Oftentimes an engineering and estimator team need to know what was already there. And then we're going to talk about what we think we're proposing, because we're going to get design expertise a little further down the path. But the one that always gets my mind, I'm on this call the other day with a VP of operations, and he goes, you know, a salesperson the other day, because remember that thing ranked up the most, like this friction here, and dumped 20 photos into SharePoint or Dropbox for me. That does absolutely nothing for an engineer. They have no idea what that's associated to. So Trad, can you open that? This is a fast, fast, fast association. So when you think of System Surveyor, we're at sites, then we have tons of surveys you can have under them. You can folder them. Then you have these icons are called elements. And then each element, you could be taking a picture, whether it's a door or a camera or whatever. So Trad, can you open that picture again? Imagine now that if you had sent a PDF, remember we challenged the PDF thing. You had sent a PDF. We do have something with a camera roll as a PDF, but you would miss this association. And a lot of times what's also is cameras, we also might take a picture of what they want it to be looking at. It's kind of tricky to do that in Trad's office. So we pause there for a moment. This has returned the ROI for System Surveyor for many companies. Cause they're like, and that information is not traveling down the path. And it seems so simple. It's easy for us to demo it and fly by this, but it right here is important. So Trad, why don't you press on to your next thought here?
Yeah, thank you. So again, really important to emphasize, and I think with everything we're showing you, it's as we've been told by customers, they basically ask themselves, again, what info do I need to capture? It's important to ask yourself that, your organization, and do what works for you. But what we do here time and time again, Maureen talked about the device status that was down on that device. So it's really easy to just track this and say, all right, you know what, that actually needs to be upgraded. You can go back, reference that for the team. The other tab we really would encourage you to take a look at as you build out your steps is the install tab. That's something that, again, if you don't capture that, you're going to have to go back on site, going to have to roll an additional truck. And what we consistently hear is that the door material is just so you know what you're going to be working with right there. And actually, let me go back to the photo or the camera we were on. Let's talk about that mount surface. So if you know you want to put that into a corner, and then maybe you need to be punching through a cinder block, that's two elements that are really important to know so your team is going to bring the right material out on site if you're working off that camera. If there's anything, too, that you need to add, that freeform notes field down at the bottom is something we really would encourage people to, while you're looking at it, take notes on anything that you're thinking of while focusing on that device.
Yeah.
Maureen,
I'm going to jump in real quick, one sec. There are some growth hacks here that you can think about. Hacks is a weird word to me, but I know people love growth hacks. Duplicating devices, and maybe I'm stealing Trad's thunder, is super powerful. Again, maybe this one was even busy. What if you had one integrator? I know Matt Pruitt, my buddy over at TSI, he puts like three icons on. So he doesn't have to be dealing with the icons on the left and dragging and dropping. He's got a hyper focus with that customer during that site survey. So he'll go in and he'll go, can you duplicate one of those cameras? So some of the things you just did, you would only need to change one factor about it, not six things. And so you might be like, oh, here, we're in a totally different space. And by the way, we're going to need a ceiling mount there. Most people want to be fairly generic here. They're not always picking the vendor product. You can. Yeah. But that's something we're going to talk about that in the workflow. So that duplicating, we're going to do a 10 camera system. We're going to do 10 doors. You want a little bit of speed and at least getting the mock-up of that. So we're kind of, like you said, we're not trying to demo so much here, but what we hear have been like some little good little scalability hacks. Yeah. Okay. And press on there. Sorry.
No, you're good. I think that's a great segue to looking at the desktop. Just a few ways we would encourage you to make a part of your process so that you collaborate well, but please save this once you're done and you finish that. All you need to do is upload that and it'll be available on the desktop as we check that out right here.
Right. So we may not have said it because we say these so many times, you guys. We were on the iPad app. We're also on the iPad tablet. We're on the tablets. So those are native applications. A little word to the wise, you really don't want to be internet connected during those, because it's too much on and off. So then when you get into really solid Wi-Fi, we're going to recommend not hotspots aren't the greatest. Get to good Wi-Fi. And now that sync up to the cloud, which is Amazon, where we're hosted, we're a business-to-business SaaS application. Some people don't know that. They'll use the web browser on the tablet. That's okay. But it's not going to be as conducive to what we were oriented towards. So, okay, now over to you, Trev.
So once you do that workflow, like Maureen said, we've mentioned it already, but it's super, super easy to quickly add a solutions engineer, a rep from your favorite manufacturer as a guest user. So you can get their input, you can go out and do another job that afternoon while you choose their permission level and really just invite them as a guest to look at what you've done, maybe make comments. It's something that we would really encourage you to look at making part of your process. And then as we kind of wrap up here, we'll look at the two most popular reports we have. The first one we would say, please still use when you're interacting with that manufacturer. It's the bill of materials. Hopefully, it's something everyone is familiar with and is already working with. You've already done this work. You've dragged those devices out. You're just pulling the data so you have your accurate counts. And you know you're going to get your quote back to your customer a lot quicker because this is done for you. The next report is the floor plan with legend report. I actually talked to somebody this week who said, I send this to the customer the second I get back to the office, make a few tweaks, but I get it back to them and tell them it's basically a deliverable to say, hey, thanks for having me out. This is what we looked at. I'll get that exact quote to you back very shortly. So again, you've done this work. It's there for you. Please look at this report. We do think it's a really valuable add. Maureen, anything you would add as we wrap up here on the demo?
Well, I'm going to touch on a mistake that we see. Mistake is a strong word. Maybe it's better to say it's an opportunity. But because the sales to estimation engineering and ops handoffs, it comes back to this PDF situation. We're talking about a dynamic, very digital metadata situation here. And so I've seen some people use it in sales, and then they go, oh yeah, I'll just ship that PDF off to my next step in the team, whether it's pre-sales or even post-sales. And then the engineering team's like, well, wait, what is this thing? I don't, thanks. Why don't we pick up Survey and drill in maybe the one we were on, and again, look at the photo or another piece. You don't want to miss that. That's the point. Really, I think this is a collaboration software, maybe even more than a drawing tool or a design software. It's about, and on the left, you see you could pull in team permissions. So you can invite other licensed users. But the people I see really moving the needle on the scalability, which is what this webinar is about, they go, I'm not going to just, you can Zoom way in. There, we have some commenting capability. We might use color coding. I had an amazing meeting with the University of Wisconsin yesterday, who actually works with their integrators, but they also work with their stakeholders. And they use color coding to mean really important different things. But can you go down to that one camera and open again that I have a photo? You export a PDF, you've just lost that piece. Then, if you think about the later part of the life cycle, what if you could take a picture of what was actually installed? I have a feeling some of you might have had an experience where someone goes, yep, you guys didn't install it where we wanted. Oh, that's going to affect a project margin. And you can say, well, I mean, we actually have this all gathered and kept. So sometimes I've had people be like, well, but well, those people don't have iPads. I think if you really looked under the covers of the scalability and the investment of keeping this all digital and creating a digital as-built is extremely powerful to this whole question of scalability. I don't think I have too much more to say on that. Just watching time, we probably need to go over and cover this. Trad, we kind of talked about this is a really great document also for a workshop to say who lives in each part of this process. And that could, a lot of times the gathering and site requirements is the sales team, right? And they, what do the four things that they need to capture every single time? When you export it and bring it and design cleanup at the office, for a teeny tiny company, that still might be the same salesperson. We've got a lot of big companies on this webinar, and they're going, well, I've got this estimation engineering team. They're going to do the design cleanup, and they're going to actually pick the actual products that we're going to be doing. And they're usually doing that at the web a big percentage of the time. What else would you say about the next two steps, Trad?
I think with sharing and collaborating, we've really tried to touch on that a fair amount. It's just something that, frankly, we want people to just test it out, see what again works for you on this workflow. I think this is designed to be an outline for people to hopefully prompt themselves with questions and look at where they can standardize on. With the fourth step there, though, to those proposals and reporting, we talked about a few of those that are hopefully really helpful for everybody. Again, you're already doing all that work. It's just really there for you to pull. And I would encourage people to, because sometimes we'll get on calls and they're not aware of certain reports, just play around with it, mess around with different combinations and really see what works for you and your team. And then hopefully build it into an easy playbook for you to relay to the sales team, new hires, anybody that's getting familiar with your business.
Yeah, you know, again, talking to so many people who are trying to scale their business, when you're automating a bill of materials during the design process, you're ahead of the game, right? And what's actually happening is hopefully all those hours that were typically spent doing that work sort of in a linear, you know, way is all sort of happening in real time. And that's the idyllic view anyway. All right. Well, I think you guys could use that. Happy to do some consulting with you. I think it was time for us to go into a bit of a Q&A. And I think Mindy was going to let us know some of the questions. Or do I have the Q&A here? Sorry. Let me pull that up.
Perfect. Yeah. And we've got a few. Let's see.
Yeah, Trad, do you want to take the first couple there?
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
So somebody asked, is there a way to view all the photos we've taken at once? Yeah, so that's a good question. There's a few different ways to do that. If you are on the new version of the app 2.0, you actually can do that in the app now. Please check that out. It's really nice, especially if you're on site with the customer. Like Maureen said, you also can pull that in a PDF report. She wouldn't want you to send that to people, but you can look at it if you want to that way. So there's a few different ways to look at that. And then next question looks like it's about software license. How's it priced and can we try it? So yes to both. It's priced as a subscription model per user. You can do it annually or monthly, whatever fits best for you. And we do have a free starter account that you can sign up for on our website. There's no expiration date on it. We would encourage people to look at that and just see if that's a good fit. Let's see.
It looks like one is, can we do design without going on site? Can I touch on that one? It's because I have a...
Please.
So a couple of salespeople that are excellent in this market sometimes actually do some pre-qualifying before they actually go on site. But it's actually very similar to what we just did on this webinar today. They might, again, still get the floor plan. They set up a Zoom. They get on video. They pull in who needs to be involved, which can be very compelling. And they actually bring System Surveyor up. That's most often on the web browser. And they've done a little design, and then there's this visualization process that's going on. And so some people don't even go to the site survey until they're actually kind of pre-qualifying, but that's an opportunity. That's a scaling hack, not one that works for every scenario. Depends what your relationship is with the customer. You want to take the next one?
So the next question is, if we do not have tablets, how do we do a site survey with System Surveyor? So that's a good question. Of course, with us being cloud-based, you can just do it on the desktop if you don't have a tablet to go out there and download the native app on. So whatever devices you have available, I'd say do that. I am a little partial to the tablet app myself, but the desktop works really well too.
Yeah, another little growth hack on the tablet front. You remember, we're not asking you to be internet connected. So, you know, some Android tablets for a couple $100, iPad, you don't necessarily need to have, you know, 3G, 4G, 5G, whatever the LTE is. That can make the device a little less expensive. What's, I think if you're thinking about scalability, again, we've done, by the way, some benchmarking on this. People who bring the iPad out and have that interaction and visualization with a customer, which takes a little practice, right? Their close rate goes higher because their confidence is being built. They're like, oh my God, these guys actually know what I want. So think hard about that tablet piece. We think it's pretty compelling, but not everybody uses it. Good question.
Yeah, and then Warren, looked like Miguel asked, does the app work on iOS and Android? Yes, it does work on both of those.
Yeah, and let's say the tablet's not currently on the phone, not as much real estate there. So if you were to go to the, you know, iOS phone, you may not find, but you won't just want to search System Surveyor, get our 2.0 app on either one of those, the Google Play Store or Apple Store. Oh my gosh, we are at 11:40. I think we hit our time a little bit better than last time. We went over about 10 minutes. Welcome to any more questions. You know, we take what we call a product-led growth approach to the market, which means we let our product earn your business. It's not going to solve for every single thing. I think that we're, you know, really helping drive the sales and the ongoing operations opportunity. But we encourage you to go to that free trial. Like Trad said, that we don't time limit that. I think one of the main ones is people go, oh, I'm on a survey and I want to put the 26th icon on there. And they're going to go, okay, well, I need to upgrade. I can do that online. But we're also working with very large enterprise customers that have 75 to 100 licenses, and they're doing some deeper planning. You know, they need single sign-on. Trad is going to work with you, but we'll work with really any size. So we're serving the SMB to larger, and I hope really helping them address the scalability opportunity. Trad, any parting thoughts from your side?
No, I think that's really it. Again, please let us know what you think. Take the survey down there. And for those of you that have been with us today, last time, hopefully you've gotten something out of this. And just reach out with any questions, please. If there's anything we didn't address, we really want to hear from you. But we really appreciate everyone's time.
I should
time.
Probably say one more thing on behalf of our operations team, because we have ops too. We have a new help center on our website. It's more searchable for those of us, you know, those of you who had known us for a long time. We run webinars on how to use it. We can get in a deeper one if you want. We have a new user. So we really try to help you get to the most optimization of using the software. And we just look forward to working with you. Thanks to our community for coming out. And please take the survey if you can. Tell us what we could do a little bit better or how to make it more valuable to you. Thanks, Trad.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye, you guys.